what it is a redoubt. You feel me? Nah.
Nah.
Nigga, but why I keep fucking up? Fuck, bitch.
Wish you could be here with me. House out on the enemies. Things ain't been the same. Everything changed after your sentencing. Now my right hand man like Captain Hook, lost in extremity. Till we meet again, I'll always hold on to our memories.
Used to pop out on the ops with you blowing chops at him. We was running blitzes, I ain't talking no mad. When I heard it hit you with an elbow, my heart shattered. I'ma up the stone on him. When I do a start grabbing, we was running down on everything that wasn't rocking with us. He was fucking with us, but he wasn't rocking with us. Always had a lot of bitches and a lot of opposition. I traded all in and got my partner out of prison now, yeah. I ain't think that losing you would hit me that hard. Always had it hard, both of mama's hitting that hard. Ain't no question about it, though I'm missing my dog. Body else forgot you, but you sit behind bars. Pray one day you get a sentence reduction. A lot of shit changed out here since we been stuck. And I quit fucking around cause it's hurting the drugs. And the police getting stronger, still mentally struggling.
Man, what's good? Y'all tapping into Urban Moguls with B. Right here, we drop the most game, man. Before we start this interview, I need y'all to go hit that subscribe button, that like button, that notification bell, and then leave a comment at your own will. Man, we right here with a real special guest, man. He goes by the name of A. Wax. On Wax.
What's up with it? A. Wax, Pittsburg, California.
Hell yeah. Yeah, man, so, you know, part of the first question, you already answered, Pittsburg, California. But just let them know what you do. For people who don't know what you do, and what's your ethnicity?
I do music. I do music full-time. I'm a musician, and I'm a whole mix of bullshit. I'm mixed with all kind of shit, a long list of it, but I'm mostly Sicilian.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I would have never guessed that. So yeah, man, growing up in Pittsburgh, what was that like, man? You had any siblings? What was the household like?
Yeah,
both parents?
I grew up with siblings. I had a dysfunctional family. So my mom and dad had an ugly divorce, and it went beyond typical divorces. So I had to navigate through that. And my mom used to move a lot. So although I'm from Pittsburgh, once my parents got divorced, my mom used to move me around a lot of places. So I stayed in Long Beach, I stayed in Atlanta, Georgia, I stayed in Seattle. My mom used to just always uproot me and bring me to different school districts. So I bounced around a lot, but I always came back to Pittsburgh every couple of years, shit like that.
Hell yeah. And so was you guys all moving together, or you would just bounce around with your mom?
Just with my mom. We would move. My mom and my siblings, we would go to different places. My dad, I had a real dysfunctional family,
yeah.
So my someone in my family had I gotta turn that off.
It's all good.
Someone in my family was on the run for a case and was on America's Most Wanted, and my dad tried to hire him to take my mom's out so he wouldn't have to pay child support. So my mom was running from that issue, so she would always move somewhere, and then when my dad would figure out where she was, she would uproot her somewhere else because she was scared of the backlash from that, and it actually coming true one day.
Hell yeah. I'm about to ask you a question, but before I get there, you know, now that you know in the situation of that, do you have any animosity towards like pops, or it's like it's just like whatever, it's like you have the picture, it's just I ain't worried about you?
Nah, it is what it is. Everybody make their own. Nobody perfect. Everybody make bad decisions in life. Right. You know, my father got married to my mom. My mom was real young when they got married, and when I was born. So it was kids raising kids. And so you really can't expect too much maturity out of that scenario. So I don't hold no grudges toward it. But there was a time in my life when I was young that I did hold grudges. It took me time to mature, to move past that and just realize, look, my parents is older than me. They're going to be gone one day, and I don't want to ever look back at the scenario like, could I try to be a better son in my way? If I'm gonna be scrutinizing their parenting, then I gotta look at how I am as their child and how I act too, and take some responsibility for my actions.
Right. Yeah. Well said. Bouncing around, man, city to city, maybe school to school. I know what that's like. It gets frustrating. You feel me? It's hard to trust people because you meet different faces all the time, and it's hard to just get comfortable somewhere. What was your experience like, man, going from Northern California down to Southern California and then all these other places you go into?
I mean, because the curriculums change when you go, I didn't realize that. So things that I learned in the California school district didn't travel along with me to other states. It was like stuff I learned two grades earlier. So when I was in school, it was like nothing. I was just pure bored. I ain't had nothing to do but cat off and fuck off when I was in the other school districts. So I got into a lot of trouble and just because I had nothing to do and being young. So I was always the one teaching everyone how to shoot dice in the bathroom for their lunch money and cheating them on out they shit. And I was always doing that kind of stuff. So, I mean, for me, it was fun though. It wasn't a bad thing, but I always had a problem with authority. I never liked authority or any kind of rules, people telling me what I couldn't do.
Yeah. Was it easy to adjust when you moved down to down south? Because, you know, coming from Northern California, some people have like that, oh, we're better than you guys, or, you know, kind of attitude.
No, at that point, I was too young. It wasn't like,
okay.
That was one of the earlier moves in my life, so it wasn't like a part of my life where I wasn't off the porch yet. I didn't get off the porch until I was probably 12. Around age 12 is when I got off the porch, actually, and started figuring out the streets and doing all that. Before that, I just had I had a pretty childlike, I had a good, just a watch cartoons, eat cereal as childhood.
Right, right.
Like, it wasn't too much or nothing, you know what I mean?
Yeah. So when it comes to the streets, I don't talk too much about streets, but, you know, how are you able to maneuver, man, and, like, continue to keep a positive mind and you know, become successful coming out the trenches?
I went to jail when I was 16 years old. I got tried as an adult, and I had to go sit. I had to grow up fast. I had to be around adult inmates doing life, and I just had to... I had no time for mistakes in there. You don't get to make mistakes or do none of that shit when you're in there. Every little thing that you do, it could lead to you never coming home, whether it be you get killed in there or you catch more time in there. And so I had to navigate that and learn how to conduct myself and how to treat people with respect and also demand my respect back and tread that fine line before I learned that. It wasn't somewhere I wanted to be. Like when I first got to prison, it fucked me up because I was on the main line, and it was when I'm in the yard, it just threw my brain back for how many people can't actually read or write in there. People used to pay other inmates to write letters home, to write their family home for them because they weren't capable of writing. They just lied through school and didn't take the time to learn to do math or any kind of gain any knowledge through school. So that right there struck me first, and I was 16 years old with adults, and I had a better education than them. So I felt like I didn't even pay attention, and they were way worse than me. And I felt like I'm smarter than these people, majority of them. How do I find myself in the same situation as them? So it made me do some soul searching and self reflecting and looking in the mirror, so I could see, if I'm better than that, I gotta do better for myself. I gotta find something better and not be impressionable. I gotta not try and impress people who aspirations is to land up in there with all the people that wasn't as smart as me and didn't have as much common sense and just knowledge and hustle and drive and ambition in them. I always knew that I had something better for myself planned.
Yeah. And was someone there kind of like coaching you?
A lot of people. There's a lot.
Older cats?
It's just, jail is jail. So you got people that's actually crazy. You got people that did fucked up, unspeakable things. And then you got real good people that made one mistake on one split second of their life and they in there forever. Mm. And just seeing that. Well, you got people raised right, good family systems, everything. I've met people that was professional tennis players and people that own businesses, restaurants and professional basketball players and all kind of, it's everything just smashed in one. So the ones that I could gain knowledge off, I gained knowledge off them. I hit the books, I read a lot of books in there, and the people that I felt could really teach me something, I would listen to what they had to say, as opposed to just sitting there and just talking shit about everybody on the yard and just always staying in the mix. Like, I went through my phase of that where I got in fights, lost a lot of good time before I actually settled down, and I didn't want to just stay in the mix. We called it the mix back then. Yeah. Everybody just stay in the mix and try and pit him to fight against him or diss somebody and just be on some gangbanging shit all day. Like, I had to go through my phases in there before I actually wanted to better myself and actually study music in myself with headphones and learn, teach myself how to write and do these kind of things that carried over into what I do now in life. The decisions I made then carried over to all the way to my career today.
Right. What kind of goals did you have for yourself before coming out and so that you could execute once you get out?
I had goals to just do music, but it was blind. I didn't understand no parts of the business end of the music. So I just wanted to be a rapper, but I didn't understand what it would be like to start a business, to start a record label, to fill orders and deal with distributors and on consignment. I had no idea what it entailed to be a rapper, but I knew that I was getting good feedback every time I did music. So when I would, my first songs, when I was showing to my friends and they were showing to people, I could see the feedback it was getting was always positive. So I knew I was onto something with it, but I didn't know how it was gonna happen. So I was kind of just like, yeah, I'm gonna be a rapper. And everyone was like, yeah, fucking right. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then I got out and I didn't just become a rapper. I went back to jail. I did another bid. I sat down for a little bit, I beat that case. And then I came out and then I told myself, I got two strikes. One more slip, that's life. Yeah. I'm only 21 years old. And then I said, I gotta take this serious or else I ain't got no, it's gotta be this or nothing.
Like, yeah.
At some point you get sick of seeing them bars and sleeping on metal beds and having a shower when other men are showering and just having no females around. Like, enough's enough is how I was feeling about being in there. And I know a lot of people don't nobody wanna be in jail. So I'm not like disrespecting people that are in jail, right. But at the same time, I seen something better for myself that meant more to me than trying to be in the streets and become a drug kingpin, rob professionally for a living or something. So I turned that page for myself.
Hell yeah. What do you think, you know, the hood or, you know, people of living poverty, what do they need, especially the new generation, do they need in order to do something better with their life than other than following crowds and not being, you know, following the leader type thing?
Yeah, you have to be like, I mean, I'm still from my hood. Like, I'm not an active gang member, but the way our politics work is I'm just a older head from my hood. So I try and take the younger generations and I try and teach the ones that I can how to do positive things and pursue their dreams. Doesn't matter what it is, if you got a weed brand, a clothing brand, or if you rap, if you make beats, whatever you do, I try and encourage that. And I try not to meddle with my politics when my neighborhood's at war with another neighborhood. I try not to get involved in all that. But at the same time, I love all my homies from my hood like a family. So I try and be there for them. I try to show up to funerals. I try to look out for their family if something, God forbid, ever happens to them. And lead by example,
right.
That example I showed to them. Because it ain't no words you could tell somebody when they got a fucked up home situation, if they're being abused, if they just from a fucked up financial situation and ain't got shit and gotta watch their family struggling through a situation. Yeah. They gonna do whatever it take to make it better for their family and their loved ones, which is understandable. No words could fix that kind of shit. And when all your friends and your closest homies is at war with another neighborhood and somebody kills somebody from your side, there's no words that can make that go away.
Right.
It's that's just the nature of the beast, so to speak. You see what I'm saying? So I understand the ones that's fully entrenched in it. And I love all my homies, the ones that do good and the ones that do bad the same, but I can't do nothing for the ones that's going through them, that's really out there stepping on shit.
Yeah.
There's no words I could have for them. I'm only trying to be a positive influence in their life. Right. So I don't meddle in their shit, but I also know it ain't no words from my end that I could say to encourage them except try to do better, even if it's one step at a time. Like, it ain't just, sometimes you can't just flip a switch and then your life changes. You don't have the resources, you don't have the money, you don't have a good enough people network around you and support system. all those things in place is what it takes to be able to blaze your own trail and pursue your
shit. Yeah, you gotta plant the seed first.
But sometimes, a lot of people will make an excuse out of it and be like, well, I ain't got this, so I can't do that. Well, it's not true, you just can't do it the way you wanna do it off the top. Take baby steps towards that thing, and if you're selling dope, maybe use your profits instead of buying Gucci shoes, use it to start an LLC or something, and take those baby steps to transition away from that. Is what I would say for them to do. Like, man, don't make excuses for it.
Yeah, no, that's real game. So when it comes to growing up out there in Pittsburgh, what was going on around there in your time? Because, you know, it's way different from now, you know. Yeah. A lot of shit's changed. Maybe it might be watered down or whatnot. Maybe it might be more Bay people out in that area. You know what I mean?
It was dope dealers. All it was drug dealing. It was whole tracks and dope. It was dope tracks and whole tracks out there pretty much. So everybody sold dope, and everybody had their little neighborhoods where they sold dope and they owned dope fiends and way to get money. I used to just be in a dope selling mix. I didn't gangbang till I left town and I started running with my Compton homies when I was probably like 14 years old or something.
Yeah.
So, but when I was in Pittsburgh the whole time, and we just sold dope, and it was normal in my neighborhood.
Yeah.
Everyone's parents was on dope, or everybody was selling dope. It was one of the two.
Yeah.
There wasn't too many in-betweens. So that's what Pittsburgh was like. It was just a small town.
Yeah. I didn't really know where Pittsburgh was at all until, you know, I heard about you, heard about the Jack, you know, people like that. And then it started being like Woody and people like that. Then you start doing more research and, you know, stuff like that. Oh, that's crazy.
You tweaking,
bro. Whole ass B up in here.
Man, I just flexed like a motherfucker. I ain't gonna lie. He got me sketched.
Hell yeah. Well, you know, before we close out this part one, man, what's some advice you could give to this young generation who some people might be lost and some people that might be making excuses up and down?
Hey, it's everybody that give you advice isn't trying to give you bad advice. And sometimes I know people gotta learn for themselves and shit, but you ain't gotta touch a hot stove to know it's gonna burn you. So sometimes the old heads be giving you advice, trying to take that shit and fuck what your friends think, fuck all that cool shit, and trying to impress people that ain't got nothing going for themselves. And do your own thing. Whatever you enjoy doing in life, pursue your passions and things that you enjoy doing, and follow that trail. That's what I would say.
Good talk, man. Well, hey, there you have it, man. Soak that thing up, man. Well, rewatch this part one. Soak up that game, man. He's dropping nothing but game, man. Y'all tapping into Urban Moguls with B. Right here, we dropped the most game, man. Hit that subscribe button, that like button, and that notification bell. Leave a comment at your own will, man. Let's go.